If there is one fact that we have established from our previous discussion, that is your surroundings is full of microorganisms. And in order to survive in a world, well, full of germs and pathogens, as we say, you need defenses that will prevent your body from getting diseases or contracting infection over and over again. That will be today's focus. I am Jonas, and I would like to welcome you to our class Kirby, our series of online microbiology classes. Well, if you like the contents of our videos, kindly hit the like and subscribe button. And if you would like to be notified every single time we're posting new contents, kindly hit that notification bell. Well, without further ado, let's talk about how your body combats diseases or your host response mechanisms. When we talk about your response mechanisms, when we talk about the different responses of your body against infection, we would like to further clarify what defenses are. These are basically the body's effort in order to combat different pathogens. It can be subdivided into two major classifications. You have your innate immunity, or basically the type of immunity that you are, well, born with. The moment you were conceived and the moment that you have first contact here in this world, you have these different types of body features that enables you to be protected against your outside environment. You also have your adaptive immunity, which, but as the word suggests, you do not have this upon birth. However, it was developed all throughout your lifetime. For today's discussion, we will be focusing on your innate immunity, which will basically include your first line and second line of defenses. If there will be one of your organ that acts as barriers or as a protective organ in your body, that is basically your skin. It separates you from your outside environment, which I have said a while ago is full of different microbes. Your skin primarily inhibits different microorganisms from having contact in deeper tissues. Most of your pathogens do not have the ability to pierce through or break through your skin. However, at times there will be circumstances where the skin integrity will be impaired, such as scraping, woundings, surgical incisions, and the like, that will provide a breakage in the continuity of your skin, allowing different microorganisms to enter through deeper layers of your body. However, I would like you to worry not, primarily because deeper under your epidermal layer lies a lot of mucus-producing cells, or basically your goblet cells, that produce mucus in order to trap these different microorganisms. There are several factors why your skin is effective against combating infection or combating pathogens for that matter. You need to understand that as the skin, or generally speaking, your skin is not conducive for bacterial growth. There are just some areas that will be more conducive for different microorganisms to thrive. However, majority of your integumentary system is not good for different microorganisms to proliferate. Why? The following will be the reasons. Number one, that dry epithelial keratinized cell, well, because of its dryness, it doesn't have a lot of moisture content. That's why a lot of microorganisms, based from our previous discussion, that needs water in order to perform different metabolic functions, due to the dryness of your skin, they will not be able to thrive. Also, because of the variation in terms of the body's pH, a lot of microorganisms dies. And also due to the fluctuation of your body's temperature, depending on the ideal temperature for these microorganisms to proliferate, this also results to their death. And lastly, as I've said, different mucus acts as traps, preventing different microorganisms from entering deeper under your epidermal layer. When we talk about your mucus, basically, Your mucus is not simply a trap. Within those traps, you are producing different substances that inhibits the growth or the proliferation of different microorganisms. You have your lysozyme, which basically destroys the peptidoglycan layer of bacterial cell wall that makes different bacteria more susceptible or more vulnerable to your phagocytes and different body toxins. You also have your lactoferrin. Lactoferrin binds to iron as well as minerals that are both requirements of your pathogen in order for them to replicate and proliferate. That's why with the presence of lactoferrin that will hoard all those iron, you will have difficulty in cell dividing. You also have your lactoperoxidase, which utilizes a highly reactive oxygen, which are believed to be highly toxic for different or multiple pathogens. Well, on the other areas that serves as opening or your mucosal areas, such as your respiratory system, your gastrointestinal system, as well as your genitourinary system that is lined with mucus, there are a lot of protection that your body offers in order to prevent different bacterial or whatever pathogenic infection is lingering. You have your respiratory system. Your respiratory system is basically lined with mucous membrane and irregular chambers in the nasal region that most of the time when you inhale air that is basically contaminated, you are not to worry a lot, primarily because this body structures contains different mucus that were produced by your goblet cell, trapping different microorganisms that contains all those enzymes and produce that inhibits pathogenic growth. And you also have these sweepers in your respiratory system, primarily called your cilia. These hair-like projections acts like a broomstick that traps microorganisms, preventing them to enter deeper or to penetrate deeper in your respiratory system. Also, with their movement, they are trying to push away the collected dirt or pathogens in your respiratory system out to your gastrointestinal system in order for you to dispose it through swallowing, as per, again, the WHO recommendation. That's why it is not advised for you to take anything that will damage your ciliated cells as well as your goblet cells, because these are basically your protective mechanisms against different infection. I'm talking about you smoking as well as being exposed to a very polluted environment. You need to take care of your body basically in order for it to adequately combat different infections. You also have your gastrointestinal system. That's why, for example, accidentally you have drunk a spoiled milk or probably food for that matter. You are not to worry a lot, primarily because different enzymes, microorganisms, as well as the acidity in your stomach will be enough in order to combat proliferation of different microorganisms. Combat of your diseases primarily start in your mouth, wherein saliva is present. And this saliva contains a lot of lysozyme, which aids different phagocytes to combat pathogens present in that particular area. Also, you have your digestive enzymes and different pH alterations, basically starting from a high acidic pH in your gastric area, and upon going to your intestinal area on the proximal portion to your stomach, it will still remain acidic in nature. However, as you go further, alkalinity on your gastric content is being expected. That's why changes in your pH also alters and makes different microorganisms, or it makes it difficult for a lot of microorganisms to proliferate and thrive. You also have your bile, basically a substance that is being produced by your liver that will destroy your bacterial cell wall, making them more susceptible to the outside environment that includes different enzymes as well as your pH in your gastrointestinal system, inhibiting their growth or even killing these microorganisms. Also, together with all of these enzymes, pH, there is also the presence of your peristalsis, which continues to propel your gastrointestinal system, allowing different microorganisms to be excreted together with your fecal material. You also have your genitourinary system, which basically, due to urination, flushes different microorganisms present in your distal portion of your urethra. However, if there will be problems that will lead to scanty urination, problematic urination, or even seldom or decrease in frequency in terms of urination, that might lead or be a causative factor why you are to develop UTI. Among female clients, I would like you also to understand and remember, based from our previous discussion, especially during the age that they are ovulating, their vaginal pH is basically a little bit acidic in nature, preventing different microorganisms to proliferate on that area. Having that said, that factor can also prevent accumulation or occurrence of different infectious diseases. You also have your microbial antagonism as your primary or first-line defense. These microbial antagonists or your indigenous microflora basically inhibits bacterial or pathogenic growth through three processes. Number one, due to their residence, they do not allow different newcomers or your pathogens to basically proliferate and have an area to for them to thrive. Number two will be they produce different antibiotics that inhibits the proliferation of these pathogens in your body. And number three, because they are already resident or always present in your body, they are used or they take most of the nutrients that will be made available to your pathogens. That's why in the presence of this indigenous microflora, it will be difficult for different pathogens to infect and proliferate your body. However, it's not always absolute that your body through these mucosal areas, the skin that you have, as well as your indigenous microflora, it's not always that all these factors will be enough to combat the entry of your pathogens. This will be the portion wherein another backup army of the body will be introduced in order to combat different infectious diseases. And I'm talking about your secondary line of defense. When we talk about your secondary line of defense, we're basically talking about different chemicals. Your fever accumulation or the fever cascade, as well as your inflammatory responses in your body. We start with your chemicals that are being produced by the body in order to combat infection. Number one will be transferrin. Similar to that of your lactoferrin, it basically hoards your iron that is necessary for pathogens to proliferate. In the absence of iron, pathogens will simply be phagocytized without the ability for them to proliferate or increase their numbers. You also have interferons. Interferons are basically produced by different cells that were infected by different viruses or by a virus. Despite their inability to protect their own from destruction brought about by the virus, they release interferons that will coat proximal cells, preventing the attachment of newly produced or sensitized virions. I would like you to understand that interferons are not virus-specific. Meaning, if interferons are produced, multiple viral infection can be combated. However, it is said to be species-specific. Meaning, only interferons that were produced for humans will only protect humans and will not protect animals. That is basically the reason why SARS-CoV-2, the causative agent for your COVID-19 disease, though present among animals, they have innate protection or immunity against this particular pathogen. However, humans, such as us, does not have this kind of immunity. Ergo, we are being infected by COVID-19 disease. You also have your cytokines. Your cystokines basically regulate the intensity as well as the duration of your immune responses and stimulates the proliferation and differentiation of different combating cells, primarily your WBCs or your leukocytes. It is believed that your cytokines enables different cells of your body, particularly your immunity and WBCs, to communicate with each other, allowing to determine how they are to react in a particular invasion of your pathogens. You also have, lastly, your acute phase protein, which is basically increased in the event there will be invasion of different pathogens in your body, or what you call infection. These are at times being tested in order to determine different cellular damage present within your body. It increases resistance to infection as well as facilitates tissue repair, which are all vital comes the time that different tissues of your body will be damaged. Example of your proteins present in an acute phase of injury or inflammation and infection will be basically your C-reactive protein, your serum amyloid, protease inhibitors, as well as coagulation proteins. Together with these chemicals, the body will now call for reinforcement due to the inability of your first line of defense to combat different pathogens. And I'm talking about your phagocytes. Your phagocytes basically facilitates phagocytosis, a process wherein these phagocytes will engulf and consume different pathogens. When we talk about phagocytes, we're basically referring to your neutrophil, macrophages, as well as natural killers. Let's start with your neutrophil. Your neutrophil are basically your first line of, or first defenders, or first type of WBC that will go to the site of infection in order to combat your pathogen. They will try their best to contain infection on that particular area. However, this neutrophil, despite them being rapid in terms of their response time, the ability for them to kill microorganisms only happens once because they're basically kamikazes. Meaning, upon exposure to a particular pathogen, in order to kill that pathogen, they will basically self-destruct. Well, you're familiar with the product of your neutrophilic self-destruction. That is basically the white color or discoloration in your skin present when you're developing acne. I'm talking about your pus. Pus is basically the remnants of your neutrophils that experience war against pathogen. However, despite this neutrophil being early in the site of infection, at times they will not be enough in order to fully combat these diseases. That's why they're gonna call for a stronger phagocyte, which is basically your monocyte. Your monocyte, upon escaping your blood system and entering the tissue that is infected by different pathogens, will now evolve as your macrophage. Unlike your neutrophil, your macrophage can facilitate phagocytosis over and over again, like a boss. Well, your macrophages basically can be divided into two major categories. You have your macrophage that basically has the ability to be motile, or your free macrophage, as well as those macrophages that are considered to be fixed, both of which has cytoplasmic extensions that enables them to attach themselves to different pathogens, allowing them to bring them closer and thus engulfing different pathogens. These macrophages are effective in cleaning up infection as well as combating different infectious pathogens that is within your system. However, it's not just your neutrophil as well as macrophages that combats infection. You have a very unique cell called your natural killer cell, or basically your NK cell, that despite them not being phagocytic by nature, it facilitates death of different pathogens by performing apoptosis. Apoptosis is basically poking through your pathogen, creating a hole that will allow water to go in. Through the process of apoptosis, these cells will later on lyse and burst. However, I would like you to understand that these natural killer cells has the ability to detect different cells if they are normal or not. They also have a unique capability to combat your own cell if they are infected by different viruses. I'm talking about the presence of your major histocompatibility complex or your MHC1. Your MHC1 are basically produced by normal cells. However, if they are being infected or being invaded by different microorganisms, there will come a time that they will stop producing your MHC1. This will be detected by your NK cells or your natural killer cells and thus will kill that particular cell. Okay? Through, again, apoptosis. However, these pathogens at times will not, or these phagocytes at times will not be enough to combat infection. That's why your macrophages together with your mast cell as well as different cells of your body will produce or will initiate the accumulation or the phenomenon or the incidence circumstance wherein there will be an increase in your body's temperature. I'm talking about fever. When we talk about fever, we're basically pertaining to an event wherein you are increasing your body's temperature in order to combat different pathogens present in your system. These are basically caused by your pyrogens or your pyrogenic substances that contributes to the fever production. But how exactly is fever being produced in your body? It basically starts at the time wherein different bacteria will start to invade your body or different pathogens will invade your body. These pathogens will release endotoxin to the patient's bloodstream, now warranting different phagocytes through the process of chemotaxis to invade that particular site of infection. Now, these phagocytes will engulf this toxins as well as your pathogens, now as a result producing interleukin-1. Your interleukin-1 is basically a pyrogenic substance that when interleukin-1 or your IL-1 will stimulate your hypothalamus will now produce your prostaglandin. Upon metabolism of your prostaglandin, it will adjust your hypothalamic thermostat, meaning it will tell your hypothalamus, "Hey hypothalamus, we need to increase your temperature in order to combat infection." Thus, your body's thermostat will be elevated in a degree which is a little bit higher than normal. That's why you're experiencing fever. Now that the thermostat has been set higher than normal, the body will do several reactions in the attempt to balance out or to achieve that newly established thermostat. How? Number one, by vasoconstriction. Vasoconstriction conserves heat within our body, thus increasing or continuously increasing the temperature internally. Also, you have different mechanisms by which fever is being facilitated, which will be explained as we go on through our discussion. However, what exactly are the effects of fever in your body that allows the body to combat different pathogens? Number one, fever basically stimulates WBC development, deployment, in order to destroy different invaders. Your WBC can be pictured as the army of the body, basically being called when the time that a pathogen will now invade different systems. Number two, hyperthermia or fever also reduces plasma iron content. And what was discussed a while ago, according to what was discussed a while ago, iron is vital for different pathogens to proliferate. In the absence of iron, basically, cell proliferation will be impossible. You also have, again, interleukin-1 production, which allows proliferation, maturation, as well as activation of your lymphocytes, another cell that is responsible for your immune defenses. A while ago, we have discussed the process of apoptosis, wherein a natural killer cell will basically poke into your pathogen in order to promote the death of the pathogenic cell. Basically, this happens through your complement cascade. Complement cascade, from the word itself, or your complement system, is basically a group of proteins that are found normally in your blood plasma. However, in the event there will be bacterial invasion or pathogenic invasion, it complements the activation of your immune system. The end product of your complement system is the accumulation or the production of your membrane attack complexes, or your MAC. As a consequence, your MAC, or your major consequences for your complement activation, will be the following. Number one, it will basically initiate and amplify your inflammation. Inflammation is something that at times we are so worried about. However, I would like you to understand at this juncture of the discussion that inflammation is a sign that your body, well, is coping up with bacterial invasion or pathogenic invasion. Number two, it affects chemotaxis, because the production of your membrane attack complex, these are like tags, IDs, that will identify who is a pathogen and who is a normal cell. Now that your body will know that this is a pathogen, it will act as if it's a homing device, pinpointing and teaching our WBC that, hey WBC, here we are and we are your opponents. It will signal your WBC who's to be destroyed and who is considered to be your normal cells. Those are basically your MACs. You also have leukocyte activation, or your WBC activation, bacterial and foreign cell lysis through the process of apoptosis, as well as increase in phagocytic activities. But how exactly is apoptosis being facilitated? This happens through the process of opsonization. Opsonization is a process wherein opsonins, or your MACs, are being attached to surfaces of your pathogens, as if you are drilling a hole. This allows the attachment of different phagocytes to your receptors, enabling now your phagocytes to, well, phagocytize your pathogens. Your MACs, like your opsonins, however, facilitate cell death by drilling a hole in that particular pathogen, facilitating the movement of water from the plasma membrane going to the inner portion of the cell, now allowing or resulting to lysis, or marking the bacteria as the target of different macrophages as well as neutrophils. All of these secondary defenses basically occur simultaneously within their body. They have a strategic plan on how they are to carry out their actions. I'm basically talking about your inflammation response. But how exactly does inflammation occur in our body? It will all start in the point or in the time wherein there will be an injury on your tissue. Because of your injury, inflammation will now occur in order to limit and localize that particular pathogen. How exactly does it happen? It will start with the production or synthesis or production of your histamine molecules by your mast tissues or your mast cells. This histamine, together with your prostaglandin activation, will promote vasodilation. Vasodilation in a sense that it will be vasodilated for the area of injury. However, generally speaking, when there is an accumulation of your pyrogens, it will result to vasoconstriction all over the area. So the only area that will be vasodilated is again the area of infection. Why is it vasodilated? Vasodilation basically increases your vascular permeability, allowing fluid plasma to escape your blood system going to your tissues. That's why when there is injury, you can observe edema. Namamaga ang area. Also, Because of the vasodilation or the dilation of your blood vessels, it allows an increased blood flow. Increased blood flow is equivalent to increase in the delivery of different formed elements, and that will include your RBC, resulting to redness on that particular area, and number two, your WBC, which are being sent by your body to combat these pathogenic microorganisms. These phagocytes, due to vasodilation will give a gap in your epithelial coverings, allowing different pathogens to escape your blood works going to the infected tissue or organ, where the primary responders, being neutrophils, will start to combat infection as early as possible. However, they will not at times, or most of the times, will not be able to completely eradicate your pathogens. It comes the second type of phagocyte going to the site, your monocyte, when migrating to your tissue, will now evolve to your macrophage. And your macrophage, unlike your neutrophils, have the capability to perform phagocytosis over and over again. With the inability to combat pathogens and infection, macrophages will release pyrogenic substances that will in turn result to systematic fever. Your pyrogenic substances will again adjust your thermostat present in your hypothalamus, will now determine the new normal temperature for your body to achieve. When fever happens, metabolism increases. This will increase the cellular growth and signals the liver to at least keep this or store your iron supply, inhibiting the further availability of your iron for your pathogens in order for them not to proliferate. And lastly, if all of these things fails, including your first line of defense as well as second line of defense, we are now to call the Navy SEALs of the body. Basically, your adaptive immunity. That basically ends our discussion from your innate immunity or for your innate immunity. I would like to wish everyone that you all stay safe as the quarantine period progresses. And again, this is Jonas reminding everyone that learning is always a fun experience. Goodbye and God bless.